Good afternoon, everyone. First, I would like to thank the ML CTO and APT Met for inviting me to join a beautiful conference in very beautiful city. Today is my honor to be here to present. I was informed to be presenting one case. I don't prepare for a very long lecture, just see the case and discuss. I will start with the case. This is a 64 years old male. He has a history of recurrent stroke and also dyslipidemia, hypertension, and type 2 diabetes. And he presented to our clinic with the dyspnea on exertion without chest pain and abnormal ECG. This is the current medication. He got cyclosporine and clopidogrel from neurologist, and this is a antihypertensive and statin and also the metformin. In our practice, in the patient with a intermediate risk of CAD, we send the patient to do the non-invasive testing. In this case, we send the patient to do CMR. The CMR showed a normal ejection fraction of the LV about 58% with a multi-segmental adenosine-induced myocardial ischemia compared with a multivessel disease. And some scar, sub-endocardial scar, not much scar, and all viable is viable. We schedule the patient for coronary angiogram. The angiogram performed from the right radial approach. You can see angiogram show the CTO of very proximal LED. I think they change my slide and do not make it a loop. You can see the total occluded of the proximal or very austere LED. Also in this slide, you can see, you cannot see the stump at the very austere. Yeah, the CO segment is like a 2 cm. On the right, you can see the CVS stenosis on distal RCA, and the RCA provide the collateral to the mid to distal LAD. You can see the very, very good collateral from the septum and also the PDA. And the CTO score in this case it was 3. And we talk with the patient which one should be the choice of management, medication, cath-based or PCI, because the patient, he has multiple episodes of stroke. They don't want to go bypass surgery, and he wants us to perform the PCI. When we analyze the angiogram carefully, can you guess which one is the austere proximal cap of the CTO? Professor, do you want to choose or guess A, B, or C? Yeah, I'm not sure because I'm not sure. This is a global chronic total occlusion crossing algorithm that's published in the JACC 2 years ago. Is there is the proximal cap ambiguity? If the present of the sideband, we can use the IWAS to guide anticoagulant puncture of the ostium. This is a cartoon show how to use the IWAS guide anticoagulant puncture. We put the guide wire into the side branch and put the IWAS to identify the ostium or proximal cap of the CTO. And we put the wire and microcatheter to puncture the proximal cap of the CTO. This is strategy of the PCI in this case. We plan to use a dual injection, and we choose the 7-vein femoral and 6-vein radial from the diagnostic procedure. And we use the XB 3.5 guide catheter for intricate approach. First, we put the wire into the, I'm not sure it is the first diagonal or very much band, but we cannot clearly see the proximal cap. Then we put the guide wire into the first septal band, and we check the angio when we see the proximal cap. This is a missing part of it. You can see that this is a camera of the IWAS, and you can see at this point, you can see the proximal cap of the CTO at the 5 o'clock. This means the true proximal cap is here, not here. So we put the Elong microcatheter with the Pilot 50Y to puncture the proximal cap. This is the IWAS real time that we pull back from the septal band. Now you can see the Pilot 50Y go in here into the intra part of the CTO. So I think this is inside the part. So we put the microcatheter into the CTO segment. We try. This is an example of the elong microcatheter. There's a two size, 1.7 and 1.9 French. This is the state tip one. This is the there's the three layer structure, and for the coronary artery there's one marker. You can see only one marker, and you can put like a standard 0.14 guide wire inside this one. And the good thing is there is a support extension guide wire. This can be used like an extension guide wire to exchange the wire or something like that. It's very useful. And after that, we cannot push the Pilot 50 long enough, and we have to change the catheter to the concave bore guide wire and try to navigate the concave bore to the distal true lumen. But we have some difficulty to cross the concave bore wire to the LED. It always go to the diagonal bands. And we de-escalate from the concave bore to the Pilot 50 wire. And finally, we can put the Pilot 50 into the distal true lumen. And we advance the elong microcatheter to the distal LED. And we discheck the angiogram and confirm that the microcatheter inside the distal true lumen. So we change to standard white Chiang blue wire and remove the microcatheter. Next, we do the balloon predilatation with a 2-0 balloon. This is the angiogram after predilatation. We saw some linear intraluminal filling defect in the mid-LED that was no disease before. I think we might be in the subintimal space. So we put the wire into the diagonal two and put the IWAS into the LED wire. You can see this cell LED was in the true lumen. And when we pull back the catheters, now the wire is in a very big subintimal space, you can see. And we pull back up to the diagonal two. Okay, the diagonal wire is coming here. And now we coming back into the true lumen proximally. Yeah, this is a conclusion. You can see distally we got into the true lumen, but here is we went to the very long subintimal space and we go back into the proximal true lumen again before the diagonal two segment. So we also put the IWAS into the diagonal two, and you can see the big hematoma may be caused from the concave bore wire because I mentioned that the concave bore always go into the diagonal branch, not going to the distal LED. There is a very big hematoma here. This is a conclusion after we saw the IWAT. We have a very big hematoma in the diagonal two, and our LEDY went in very long subintimal space. Should we do a one stent provisional, or should we do the two stent? But the first, we have to change the wire position because the LED wire went into the very long subintimal. So we use the real-time IWAS guidance. You can see the IWAS in the diagonal two. You can see the wire was in the four lumen. Now we put the third wire, the Pilot 50 wire, and try to navigate to septal side of the LED because we saw the wire was in lateral side of the LED, and two lumen would be septal side. We try to navigate the Pilot 50 wire. Finally, we can see the Pilot 50 wire went to the two lumen of the LED. Yeah, now you see this previous wire in the four lumen, and the third wire went into the two lumen. You can see the wire movement. I try to bring the wire into the septal band, septal side of the LED. Yeah. One last moment. Okay. Now we went to a septal side of the LED. This is in the two lumen, and we do the IWAS from the new wire. Now you can see the distal LED is in the two lumen. And when we pull back into the mid LED, you can see the previous Y. So this is a big hematoma. You can see the previous Y is in a very big subintimal space, but the new Y is in the true lumen, all the way up from the distal LED to the proximal LED. This is a septum. This is a second diagonal coming up. Now the LED Y is in the true lumen. So because of the subintimal space is really long, I debate, should we put only one, only short stent here because just close the entry point or close all subintimal space. So we decide to put the stent to cover all subintimal space. We put the 2.25 by 30 mm stent with the nominal pressure to cover the subintimal space. And in this case, we try to do a minimal contrast injection because the subintimal space is really big. And we try to do the DK crush because I don't want to lose the LEDY position. I don't want to pull back the LEDY. We put the diagonal stent and we do the crushing and the kissing, the first kissing. And we put the proximal to mid LED stent and do the kissing again. And for the left main, because I was showing the part is coming from the proximal left main to the LED, so we put the third stent from the left main to proximal LED, and we do the pot kiss pot fashion. And this is the final, after we put the four stent and with the DK crush on the diagonal two. This is the final IVA. You can see on the left main, the area is about 15 millimeters square. This is a, it's very bad. This is a proximal LED. This is circumflex, this is proximal LED, this is a mid LED stent. The area is really acceptable. This is the learning point under this case because as everyone knows, the osteo LED CTO needs special attention because it's like a left main disease. And now they're not only Y balloon guy or guy tension. I was gaining importance in the CTO treatment algorithm as we saw from the global CTO crossing algorithm. And I think in the proximal cap ambiguous, we can use the IWAS guide anti-gate cap puncture. This one is essentially useful. And I think for the everyone to do the CTO PCI, we have to prepare for the complication that might happen during the procedure and learn how to manage that complication. And also IWAS is useful, like a real-time IWAS guide lumen, true lumen entry, like I show in this case. And when we saw very big subintimal space and we have the IWAS, we can use like a minimal contrast injection to avoid the risk of medial hematoma expansion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Krishnada Mimuk.
Thank you.
A very good and very detailed illustration for proximal LED stemless CTO using IVUS guided anti-grade puncture. And then the IVUS guided a real-time re-entry to save the to recanalize the vessel true to true. And the presentation is open for discussion. Yes, please.
One question for the audience, maybe, but for all the, you can comment. And the IVUS show the distal of the LED, I think so, is don't have a more, how to say, disease. It's only negative remodeling. When you have this opportunity to use the IVUS, maybe you can select it more, how to say, short stent for try to cover all the LED, and maybe if you review this CTO in, I don't know, 1 month maybe, you can see this negative remodeling is changing and maybe the vessel is more big than 2.25. What do you think about that? I don't know, Alexander, what do you think is, when you selected this, only the occlusion is, I think so, this is small. You have, of course, the hematoma, yeah. But the hematoma is not go to the distal LED. I think so, you can select a more short stent and then, of course, cover the CTO And of course, the proximal disease of the lady, I don't know how many questions about that, but the distal, I think so, is negative remodeling only.
So thank you for your question. We were debating about this, but because we don't do the angiogram that time, and we're not sure how the lumen was compressed by the hematoma. So if we have only one chance, I want to stand all the way along the hematoma to make the lumen patency. If we put only short stent at the very after the occlusion and leave the hematoma distally, maybe the lumen may be compressed by the hematoma, and we need another stent distally. And I don't want to put the stent from the proximal to the distal. And I just want to treat the hematoma at the first time. But your idea is, we were debating, and I think it's a good idea, but we can do on a different way.
So it depends on the IVUS after re-entry of the luminal tracking IVUS. So you decide the position of the stent, distal stent,
with the IVUS.
Depends on the IVUS in true lumen.
Yeah.
Right, to prevent propagation of the
hematoma.
The hematoma.
Yeah.
Okay.
We think we are in two different scenarios. One thing is a long hematoma into the basal that expands beyond the occlusion. Another thing is the diffuse disease. Maybe the comment of Naitor was more, or maybe it's more applicable to that cases of the diffuse disease in the distal segment of the vessel, because of we saw in many cases that when the patient returned for another reasons, when we left some diffuse disease at the distal of the lesion, this negative remodeling improves the diameter of the distal lesion. But in that case, with a hematoma, maybe the behavior of when to choose or where to leave the stent changes is not the same way of thinking to choose the stand in the scenario.
Yeah, congratulations about the great case, and I would like to add one tip that how these new devices are changing our paradigm to how we deal with some before when we were dealing with this man, I was guided real time puncture. They always told us eight French, but today we actually know, okay, that was Boston Scientific IVUS, but we knew many centers are using 3.5 Volcano Philips IVUS, introducer of the IVUS part. IVUS part is 3.5 French of the Philips and 3.1 with Boston. With Boston we have space, but I don't know why is that. Maybe because we are on APT session, but Elong microcatheters are the only microcatheters in the market who with which we do Philips Volcano real-time IVUS in 7 French guiding. There is no other microcatheter. So 2.3 and 2.4 French proximal shaft diameter goes easily in 7 French, even with Volcano, with the exchanging. So it's important to know all these tools, and we can really done these cases much more easier than before.
Thank you. Very important add-on.